schiebt ihr das Rot und des Orients Grün und bemalt sein Gesicht in erhabenem Stil.
Check, check, check. Oh, yes.
Oh,
Okie dokie, team. It is time to get started with another exciting edition of Music and Civilizations featuring me, Dr. Gworek. I will be teaching today, as is usual. Hope you all have had a good week. What we're going to do is we're going to start off in chapter 33, if you remember. We cut that one a little short to get in our test review. And so we'll hit that real quick, and then we'll move on. After that comes 34, 35, and 36 today. I will have your tests graded over the weekend. You can look for those scores up in Georgia View. I promise those will be done by the next class. Okay, is everyone hearing me okay? All of my green things are green, and so I'm assuming that everything is going according to plan. All right, so chapter 33, what are we working on? Neoclassicism and tone roll music. Great, thank you. Thank you, people in chat, for letting me know you can hear me. Neoclassicism, remember we love talking about Latin roots in our music history. New classicism. New classicism, what we're going to see is some people have a rebirth in the ideals of eras long ago. And then tone roll music is a sort of mathematical procedure to music. So we have these two ideas which are essentially opposite sides of the spectrum, and we're just going to throw them into one chapter. So, neoclassicism, neo meaning new. We're attempting to capture the attitude of artists and composers of the classical period. If you look at this example right here, we have what could very easily be this classical or even Renaissance picture of two people, right? Remember we talked about the natural body lines, the asymmetrical shapes, how it's not like full-on portraits. You just change the colors here, and we're looking at something out of the Renaissance or classical era. That's Picasso right there. This attitude, a number of 20th century composers wanted to turn to the more detached, thoughtful attitude of the classical period. Hardly is the scene one would expect with such a title. I wouldn't agree with that. But, again, the flowing clothes suitable to ancient Greece or Rome. And, again, the colors just being this new style with the classical model. Neoclassicism in music. We're going to just go back to the days of Mozart, Beethoven. Going to have a lot of forms. We're going to have smaller orchestras. We're going to have shorter works. Things are going to be neat, concise, and intellectual, right? If you remember when we talked about the classical era, it was when people went away, right? We have the pendulum shifting from thinking to feeling, right? And so the classical era was the thinking era. So we're going to have a resurgence in that. That's the balance phrasing. Remember, that's when the sonata form became popular, which was like the height of intellect, classical music intellect at that time, right? Replacing the fugue as that sort of intellectual exercise. So again, we just see classical forms like sonata, rondo, theme and variations, fewer performers, shorter works. One of those, possibly one of my favorite works, is Prokofiev's Classical Symphony, right? It's called the Classical Symphony. It's Prokofiev's first symphony. He did it intentionally in the classical style. And so we see that the first movement is a sonata form, just like when Beethoven, just like when Mozart did it. This movement is less than 4 minutes long. The themes are consisted of short phrases linked together. That was, again, an idea that was more in the classical period. If you listen to Tchaikovsky or Dvorak in the Romantic era, they have these long, flowing melodies that go a lot of places, right? Whereas with Beethoven and Mozart, it's these short segments linked together, which form a cohesive musical entity. Smaller orchestra, very neat and concise music, right? Prove it. Prove it to us. By the way, I am experiencing some computer difficulties today. So if I randomly disappear, just look for a VOD later. I'll upload the rest of the lecture if I randomly cut out. Here you are, Sergei Prokofiev's first movement of the Classical Symphony. Remember, sonata form starts with the exposition. Here's our A. Now here's our transition. Again, notice the size of the orchestra, much smaller than what we were used to in the Romantic era. And here's your second theme. What year was this music? I believe the year on this is, let me actually just, I'll just get an exact year for you. The year on this is going to be 1917. Neoclassicism, early 1900s. Into the development. You hear it starting like the first theme, except it's in the minor. So you can hear he's going through most of the exposition, just slightly varied in this development. Pulling those themes in from before, as was customary of our classical era composers. Right, and then we are back to the recapitulation, as is typical in our sonata form. Again, in case you missed it during that, neoclassicism was popular during the end of the 1800s and really hit its stride in the beginning of the 1900s. You can read up on that a little bit if you like. Again, like most things, it happens in art. Then it happens in literature, then it happens in music. We always tend to get it last. What a shame. Okay. So again, that's Prokofiev, his classical symphony, first movement. That entire thing, it's a great symphony. I think total, it's under 20 minutes. Really excellent last movement. I believe the second movement is a theme in variations. What does Cengage tell us? Second movement, song-like. No, it's just song-like. But I believe that's the longest at like 7 minutes. But again, 20. It's like a 20-minute long symphony. Keep in mind, this is after people like Mahler and Bruckner are making things over an hour long. And Prokofiev said, no, neoclassicism, I like their ideas. I'm going to try to do it like Mozart and Beethoven. And he had that classical symphony. Just beautiful. Really great. Let's talk about a guy named Paul Hindemith. So Paul Hindemith wrote this woodwind quintet. Remember, a woodwind quintet is flute, oboe, clarinet, bassoon, French horn, right? The French horn is in the woodwind quintet as well as the brass quintet. Okay. So this one is done in this typical A, B, C, B, A. We call that an arch form, though they refer to it as a rondo form in this one. There's no key signature and no meter signature in this. Some of you, I would actually like to play that for you before we talk about it more, because I'd like you to try and hear what's going on. There's no, if we look here, you'll notice notes have duration, but since he changes how long he wants each phrase to be, he doesn't put it in a key. Okay? You will hear, again, this very, very ordered, very precise A, B, C, B, A form. Okay? This piece itself is only 3 minutes long. Here it is. It sounds like something out of a Robin Hood or King Arthur, right? And then this syncopated offbeat stuff sounds much more modern. Transition into our C. So notice how parts of this sound very old and parts of it sound very new. That was a conscious decision by Hindemith to really start with that unison, very dance-like, very Renaissance-sounding, just timbrely and sort of rhythmically. And then he introduces very complex things, that offbeat syncopated thing. I can tell you that's very difficult to perform. And then again, the tonal language that he uses. Sometimes it sounds very harmonic. Sometimes he has these crashing dissonances that come in. Here's the rest of that. We're going on to the B, then back to the A, and then a coda. Back to the A. That beautiful, flowing, very, very neoclassical sounding way of writing. So you heard the first theme, important notes on the beat, bom, 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 ba-da-da-dum, da-da-da-dum. The second theme with the contrary motion, the oboes and bassoons going in opposite directions, and the oboe playing off the beat. Then the third theme with that wide-ranging flute. Again, if I didn't tell you that it didn't have a key signature, that might make sense as you start to hear the more complex tonal language. If I told you it had no meter signature, it's not like it's weird. He just wrote it in a way that he wanted to change it, so he just didn't include it. So let's talk a little bit about tone row music. So there was this group of people, and one of them, the primary one being Arnold Schoenberg, who thought that tonal language, he didn't want to focus on one note. In order to give every note equal importance, he created this thing called tone row music. So tone row music is arranging the 12 pitches of an octave in order to, and then you go through them right in a row, okay? So you pick an order for your 12 pitches, and then you play one, and you can't come back to it until you've played the next one. So hang on, it's a little strange. So let me try and show you that. Okay. So if we do this. So over here, we have what we call a tone row, right? And so we have this, which is just the primary. So whoever this person is decided that this is his note order. C, A, G sharp, B, F sharp, A sharp, G, E, D sharp, F, D, C. And so every time you have to play those notes in order. And you can't go back to any other note until you play the note before it. However, we can manipulate this row in order to start on any pitch. So we can start on D sharp or E or C sharp. And then you can start here and go in this order. Prime one, right? So you can read it left to right, up or down, forward or backwards. But as soon as you start a row, you have to finish that row. And again, this is in order to not give any note any more importance than any other note. Now, there are a lot of ways in which you can use this, a lot of different processes you can do, a lot of different arranging things you can do in parts, particularly string quartets. Schoenberg did a lot with string quartets, made some very beautiful music. Okay, so again, there's no tonal center. All the notes are equally important. The tone row is the basis for the music, right? It's not a theme. That grid that I showed you is literally all the material that you need to figure out which pitch goes after. You just have to decide which rows you want to do, right, and how you arrange it. So it's not a theme, right? It's a method of composition. And so here we pay a lot of attention to the timbral things, because sometimes the textural things, sometimes the musical things might not be pretty, right? And so we're going to focus a lot on the timbre of the instruments. Okay. Again, tone rows appear in four forms, as I showed you before. They can go up and down. They can go left to right. So yeah, you can read it regularly. The inversion is retrograde is backwards. The inversion is instead of going up, you go down. Instead of going down, you go up. And then the retrograde inversion, which is backwards and upside down. Great. So again, this is Arnold Schoenberg. He's the one who created the system. Like, literally, he made it up. He's the dude. Okay? And remember, he was the teacher of Alban Berg, who did Wozzeck. And here we see Anton Webern, who is that other disciple. The second Viennese school were the three of them. Schoenberg was the boss. But that was the other name that I couldn't think of in the lecture the other day. Right, Schoenberg, Webern, and Berg. So let's listen to Schoenberg's Variations for Orchestra. We're listening to the theme of it. So we have a row played by the cellos, a row played by the violins, a row played the violins, and then a row played in high notes in the violins. What does it all mean? What does it all mean? It's just ways in which the music is organized, right? We can't really talk about theme or melody, right? We need to talk about rows. Okay. So we'll bring this over here and let's listen to it. Notice it's 59 seconds long. Most of these tone row pieces are very short, but a lot goes into them mathematically. So let's listen to it. Next row. Next row. Next row. So some of you might be wondering, well, what about the accompaniment? We only have the rows for whatever the primary instrument, the melody instrument, is in this case. Well, I promise you that all of the other instruments are following the rules of tone row music as well. They might just be doing different tone rows at that point. They're probably doing their own set of tone rows. Sometimes composers will build chords or triads or chords of three or four notes out of the tone rows. Like, they'll stack the first three on top of each other in three different instruments, and that will be a tone row. So that's one of the ways that you can innovate on the way that tone rows are done in ensemble arrangements. So let's listen to another example of that. Webern's Five Pieces for Orchestra only requires an 18-piece orchestra, right? This tone row music takes an intense amount of work. For that 1 minute of Schoenberg music, it was probably as much as a comparable solo piano piece of, 10 minutes long. It's just very intense mathematically, and they spent a lot of time with it. Not saying one is harder than the other, they're just very different. So in Webern's Five Pieces for Orchestra, he does this thing called serialism, where he's going to apply tone row principles to every part of the music. He's going to do it to timbre. He's going to do it to dynamics. He's going to do it to rhythm. So he has like a grid of rhythmic things that he can do, and he's going to read through those. He has a grid of dynamic things that he can do, and he's going to read through a grid of those. So again, it's taking the principles of tone row music and making them even more complicated. Let's listen to this piece, see how that goes. There you go, the beautiful serialist work, third piece from Five Pieces for Orchestra by Anton Webern. Oh, just pulls on the heartstrings, right? Beautiful, beautiful. So that is neoclassicism and tone row music, right? We demonstrated neoclassicism by Sergei Prokofiev's Classical Symphony. Again, I encourage you to listen to that entire thing. Particularly the fourth movement is just amazing. Oh, it's so good. And there's a video of Gergiev conducting the first and fourth movements on YouTube that I suggest you check out for the judo chopinist conductor out there. We also looked at Paul Hindemith's Kein Kammer music. Hindemith was a very interesting figure historically, so really check a lot of his stuff out. He wrote a lot of solo pieces, a lot of small ensemble pieces, and in particular, some really great symphonic pieces. Very much worth checking out. Then we got into tone row music and serialism with the Arnold Schoenberg and Anton Webern. Again, coupled with Alban Berg, who wrote the opera Wozzeck that we talked about last time. They composed this particular style of composition called tone row music or serialism or 12-tone, and often referred to as the second Viennese school. So there you go. That's chapter 33. Let's move on. Any questions on that? Remember, I am looking at chat, so please, if you have any questions, let me know. I will answer as quickly and as efficiently as possible. Chapter 34, new sounds, new techniques. Hey, if you thought that last music that we listened to was weird, wait till you get a load of this stuff. We're about to blow it all out. It's going to be great. We're going to be very excited here. Okay, so remember we talked about extensions of serialism. We talked about serialism literally 1 minute ago, right? With what's his guy's name? It's Webern, right? Anton Webern. And there's his name there, right? That was extended by people like Oliver Messiaen and Pierre Boulez. Boulez, perhaps the most well-known serialist composer. Milton Babbitt did it too. Milton Babbitt was also involved in a lot of electronic composition. And Karlheinz Stockhausen did that too. He was a very interesting character. There's a lot on Stockhausen that you could read about. But they were all very much interested in this idea of serialism and continued to explore it. Again, I very much suggest you check it out. Boulez, he's got a piece for three pianos, three harps, and three percussionists, which is just incredible. Incredible. But let's talk about a truly strange dude, John Cage. In particular, he liked to do what's called aleatoric or chance music. That's in which we're going to go through random processes in order to determine what we play. One of the things that he used to do is if you got together with John Cage, if you went to his apartment, you'd be flipping coins all day so he could compose with using the random outcomes that you got. He used this book called the I Ching, the Chinese Book of Changes, in order to tell him what to compose. He like flipped coins and consulted the Chinese Book of Changes, the I Ching, right? Amazing. Used it as a way to perform. He also wrote this great piece called Child of Tree, which you use all plant material for it. And please note that the only thing is you have to use a cactus. So listen to this beautiful man play this cactus. If you've never played a cactus, it's a lot of fun. It's a really good time. That's nice. Oh, Child of Tree. Check it out. Very fun piece. So that sort of adopts an existential outlook. Things are going to happen, so let's just let things happen sometimes. John Cage is also famous for his piece 433, in which a performer sits in silence for 4 minutes and 33 seconds to bring attention to the audience of the sounds happening around them, sort of the symphony of everyday life sounds. John Cage did that as a way to raise awareness in the concert hall, right? A lot of people think it's hokey. A lot of people think it's an act. I think it's really cool. Also worth checking out is John Cage on this, it's this old television show called I've Got a Secret. And so,
water walk because it contains water and because I walk during its performance.
Piece called Water Walk.
Now, also, two things I want you to notice. Over here, Mr. Cage has a tape recording machine, which will provide much of the... Will you touch the machine so we can know where it is? Which will provide much of the background. Also, he works with a stopwatch. The reason that he does this is because these sounds are in no sense accidental in their sequence. They each must fall mathematically at a precise point. So he watches his watch as he works. He takes it seriously. I think it's interesting. If you are amused, you may laugh. If you like it, you may buy the recordings.
Two things about that. Number one, he says he has a stopwatch because everything is very precise. The manner in which he composed the piece was probably random. He probably flipped coins and did random processes. However, the performance itself is not random. All right? The the composition process is, the performance is not. Every performance that John Cage did of this piece would be exactly the same. And then the second thing is, he takes this seriously. Try and take this seriously, right? It's very interesting. There's a bathtub on stage, but try and take it seriously. Here we go.
John Cage and Water Walk.
All right, that's all I'll give you for now. The performance is about 2 minutes longer, and I highly suggest you check the entire thing out. Trust me, the ending is good. You won't regret checking it out. Okay? But that's, again, he was a proponent of chance or aleatoric music, right? Check out his stuff. It's very, very good. He did some more normal things. A lot of really great percussion ensemble works. Third Construction is perhaps his most famous of those. So, we also have electronic music. What do we like about it? Composer has total control. No performers, any pitch, rhythm, timbre, dynamic level, any of the above is possible, right? And we set it down, we hit the play button, and bada boom, bada bing, there we go. Were you the guy who discovered we could play the cactus? No, that's not me. No, I've just played the cactus. It was John Cage. He was the one who wrote for Cactus, right? Maybe he's not the one who discovered it, but he's the first person I know who wrote for Cactus. Amplified Cactus, it's important to note. Okay. But again, dealing with electronic music, this is something that we're very, very familiar and comfortable with nowadays, right? Just think about Deadmau5 or Daft Punk, right? It's electronic music, right? Of course, back then, electronic music was very different, okay? What they did was they did this thing called tape splicing, where we're literally going to record sounds on a magnetic tape. If you've ever seen a cassette tape and the sort of ribbon that's on it. And so we can cut out pieces of ribbon and then splice them back together in order to create something. Musique concrète was this French term, and it altered recorded sounds, right? We're gonna do weird things to the magnetic tape in order to change the sounds. And we can synthesize sounds. Right. At first, it was analog. Right. Again, I've said that magnetic tape that we use, but now it's all done digitally. Right. Everything now is just done digitally. Do it in GarageBand. Still, people will record things, but of course, we're altering it with some sort of software, GarageBand, Ableton, Pro Tools, what have you. I apologize, Carla. I do not have a cactus that I can perform on for you, but. One day I hope to have my own cactus. That would be nice. So let's look at this friendly face. Guy named Edgar Varèse. Great proponent of computer music, electronic music. He wrote this piece called Poème Électronique. It was created for the 1958 World's Fair in Brussels. The World's Fair was essentially a technology expo that people used to go to worldwide. It was very exciting. But Poème Électronique is done with no... It's just sounds only. It has no melody, beat, meter, or harmony. It's just this tape splicing. So there was this thing called the Philips Pavilion at the World Fair. Looked like this. It was designed by this architect. Ionesinakis and Le Corbusier, these two architects, for the World's Fair. There was a multimedia presentation going on while people walked through this involving, I believe, 125 speakers spread throughout, a slideshow made by Le Corbusier himself, and this most excellent soundtrack by Edgard Varèse. Oh, we got to get it. Also worth noting, how many of you like Frank Zappa? A great story, true story. Frank Zappa loved Edgard Varèse. So much so that he called him at his home. I think Varèse was just listed in the phone book. Zappa looked it up. As a little kid, again, Zappa was like 12 at this point, called up Edgard Varèse to tell him how much he appreciated his music. So here's Poem Electronique, premiered at the Philips Pavilion of the Brussels World Fair, 1958. It's very soothing. Try not to fall asleep during it. Ooh, if you're listening in stereo, it's real good. This is my favorite part. So I think that sort of speaks for itself, right? A lot of this music, I can tell you the process behind it, but understanding what these people were thinking when they put it together is impossible. I think it's important. I think it's great. I think it's entertaining, and I very much enjoy it. But man, I can understand why someone would think, "What the butts was that?" But it's very important. He was one of the first to do it. It's the beginning of tape manipulation and digital music. Without this, there's no Justin Timberlake. That would be a sad world. Thank you, Edgard Varèse. Moving on. Eclecticism. Adopting musical practices from everywhere. Right? We can just take a lot of these ideas that we've talked about up to this point. Boom. Slam them all together. Right? It's sort of the same idea of what mainstream composers did, right? Except mainstream composers were focused on using a bunch of different techniques for mass appeal. Eclecticism is using just a bunch of different techniques to get your job done, right? One guy here, Alan Havanas, who's looking like an album cover from the 60s. Hang on. Maybe that's where she got it. Carole King, right? And the Tapestries cover with her and her cat. Maybe that's from Alan Havanas. I'm jealous. That looks like a nice cat. So, in Alan Havanas's In God Created Whales, he uses a recording of whales, right? It's a work for full orchestra. It's programmatic, right? And God Created Whales is about whales. And at points, the sections are directed to play whatever they want. Well, there are instructions written, but it's like, use these notes or play notes in this sort of style. So it's sort of giving the performer ways in which to do a certain task and letting them do it to the way they want to do it. So it uses recordings of whales, so that's electronics. It's using aleatoric ideas. It's using oriental-sounding pentatonic melodies. It's using colorful timbres. And this one, it's about saving the whales, okay? The idea of music having a cause, we haven't really talked about that much, have we? Music was intellectual and for entertainment. Well, Alan Havanas did this to sort of bring attention to the ideas that there are struggling whale populations, right? What's it sound like? Show me your whales, Alan. Let's go. So this is the random part. The strings are given a set of notes in which they can play, and it's just create this, right? And you can hear how it sounds kind of random. Now we're in an Attenborough film, right? And the great mighty whales living in the Pacific deep. Sorry, I'll stop ruining it. Right, notice we started in 7, now we're in 6, right? That mixed meter that we've seen before. That was in Britain, that was in Mazursky. Okay, I'm gonna jump ahead a little bit. I just love how Cengage says it. 255, whales enter. Trust me, you'll notice when a whale enters. Yeah, so you can see this is still that second theme that was introduced up here based on that pentatonic scale with pizzicato accompaniment. And then through the loudspeaker in the auditorium, we have a whale break. You'll hear some things going on in the strings behind this. Great. I'm not going to keep you for that whale song. We're going to move on. But do be sure to check that out. I heard those whales practiced for a long time for that one. Okay. Hey, guess what? We're in the 21st century. Guess what? Concert music is alive and well. Well, maybe not right now. Maybe it's not well right now. Because everything's not well right now. But concert music is alive, right? We still have great classical musicians creating new things. We have classical musicians creating old things, right? People are still writing symphonies and masses and string quartets and all of that. But it's different. It continues to evolve. Things continue to change, and it always will. Technology allows performers to be in different locations. That is no much more applicable than right now. People are still getting together. You'll see on Facebook, you know, cast of Hamilton getting together to sing tunes, right? It's a thing. It's big, and it's going to keep happening, and it's going to keep expanding. And audience participation is now possible. I've been to performances where they ask you to download, like, sound files on your phone and play them during the performance. It can be pretty fun, actually. So, some cool stuff. No one can predict the future, but two things are certain. There will be music, and it's going to be different. All right? And there are some performers out there like me who are always trying to sort of push things forward and see where we can go with music and see what we can do. Because what's happened is great, but I'm excited about what happens next. So, extensions of serialism by people like Milton Babbitt, Karlheinz Stockhausen, and Pierre Boulez, right? Again, three great people to check out. Mezain, he was in a Nazi concentration camp. He wrote a piece called Quartet for the End of Time in there. Amazing. Just one of the most amazing works ever written. He also has another great piece called Exotic Birds, right? What do you want to do when you get out of the Nazi concentration camp? He loved bird watching and recording bird songs. He liked to be out in nature. Big surprise, right? So, again, check out his repertoire. It's great stuff. And, again, Pierre Boulez, also amazing. Chancer aleatoric music, creating music using random processes, right? As exemplified by John Cage. Electronic music and Edgard Varèse's poem Electronique. Eclecticism and Alan Havanas's In God Created Wales, which incorporates many different techniques, the pentatonic scale, aleatoric elements, and using a sound system in digital playback. Okay? And now music in the 21st century, we there, you seeing it, is great. Can't wait to see what's next. Okay? There are no more questions. We're going to move on to chapter 35. It's going to be great. This one, breeze easy chapter. American music before 1920. Hate to break it to you guys, but America was a pretty boring place before 1920, right? Sure, Western expansion, manifest destiny, lots of genocide, things like that, a civil war. You know, it was great. A couple other wars around borders, you know. So we didn't have a lot of time for making music, right? We were a little busy establishing a new nation. We didn't have a lot of time for culture, okay? We were behind Europe for several reasons. We were settling new land, right? The Puritans, right? If you remember, the Pilgrims came first. They didn't like art and music. They thought it was evil and frivolous. So we're not going to pay attention to that. There were very few wealthy families to serve as patrons. Remember, we had European royalty, you know, literally money going back a millennium, probably. We didn't have that here. People couldn't bring over their vast amounts of riches. All of it had to be created. And we also just sort of had this cultural inferiority complex, right? Every once in a while, we would see things from Europe, and it's like, wow, that's really good. That's real good, right? So, of course, we did get the cultural imports from Europe, so people still saw what sort of things were going on there. And that sort of just became the psychological complex with Americans. Art in America? Simple. Simple down to earth. You'll notice Grant Wood's American Gothic, representing the idealistic, simple farming life of the American frontier, right? Because remember, if we're establishing big towns and cities as we expand, we're going to, like, set things back a number of years every time we have new establishments. Focusing on farming and settling and building a city, very important. More important than symphonies, right? My brother is a civil engineer. He helps make buildings stand. His job is more important than mine, right? That was a reality in America. So we have these Moravian communities. It was this religious branch. This guy named William Billings, he was actually pretty popular for the sort of religious music that he made. That was William Billings, right? American Revolution song. Chester was this old patriotic theme. How old was he? Well, it's the American Revolution. Right, so you can hear how this is done in that four-part style of church choirs, right? Very much. This was, if this was the 1770s, this is done in the style of like the 1600s, right? He was very good for that, William Billings. And he did a lot of that with religious songs too. American patriotic songs, well, we stole at least one of them, right? The Star Spangled Banner was actually an English drinking song. America the Beautiful and God Bless America are entirely American in their origin, so do rest easy. We have a couple uniquely American songs. Of course, our national anthem is not one of them. That's a shame. So in the 19th century, we have a couple names here. Please do yourself a favor and check them out. A lot of them are hymns. Some of them follow piano tradition, piano performance. Where is that? This one, Gottstock Louis Moreau Gottstock. He wrote a lot of piano stuff. And there you go. Theodore Thomas founded the Chicago Symphony. So these were important people. They weren't well-known composers that stood the test of time like people in Europe were doing at this time, though. One person who did stand the test of time, however, John Philip Sousa, famous for his march styles. He sort of codified the concert march, right? Remember, music has been used in the military tradition for a long time, right? Long, long time. And so these military bands had to perform concert music too. So John Philip Sousa went ahead and he wrote a series of concert marches in the wind band. And again, he was absolutely the most famous of them. They have a very simple style. It's based a lot on the way things repeat. It's just like an A, B, C, D, each section repeating itself. Very simple, very straightforward. And again, it's marching music. It's the sort of stuff that you might expect to hear if you go to your local parade. Here we go. The Stars and Stripes Forever. It's a quick march. On to the second strain. And repeat it. On to the trio, which is quieter. Okay, and that's very often what happens. And then they have this thing called the dogfight. You'll hear the instruments going back and forth. I'll just let you hear that. And again, these are just terms that are used when talking about marches. The dogfight, the trio. Here we go. Dogfight. Right? You get the idea. Beautiful piccolo solo. Let's go. Okay, so that's John Philip Sousa. Again, American composer, sort of codified the concert march. Very beautiful stuff. Very great. Okay, and again, that's the standard march story. Short introduction, first strain repeated, second strain repeated, trio, which has two sections, and this one is the trio and the dogfight, and that will repeat itself as well. Let's talk a little bit about Charles Ives. He was a highly successful businessman. Listen, you see that cane right there? This is a man of wealth and prosperity. He didn't have to compose. He just liked composing, right? He was just this rich businessman who lived up in New England, and he just liked to compose on weekends on his patio, right? He was very American, and so he's fond of quoting American songs. His father was a marching band leader, so he grew up in a musical family, so he learned it from a very young age. He was very innovative, though. His dad was a little bit of a thinker, too, right? One of the things that he wanted to do was he wanted to put a marching band in one key playing one thing and a marching band in a different key playing another thing and just sort of have them march through each other just to sort of hear how it sounds. Very cool idea, right? He ended up creating some amazing compositions. The Unanswered Question, perhaps one of his most famous. I highly suggest you check that out. We're going to listen to his fifth movement of his Symphony No. 2. The form is a loose ABAB with a coda. Let's check it out. What's it sound like? Tell us, Mr. Ives. You'll notice it's pretty beefy, almost 10 minutes long. And the one that you're going to hear is Camptown Races, a famous song made popular by Stephen Foster. Stephen Foster was a blackface performer, which is a very complicated American entertainment tradition. Feel free to talk to me about that if you're curious, but it's real interesting. And he's also going to do some fife and drum music, typical of the marching style. Let's check it out. The Camptown Races quote. Fife and oh, that's right. This recording is bugged. Oh, man, they haven't fixed that in all these semesters. How dare they? How dare you, Cengage? How dare you? You're doing a disservice to your students by not fixing this link. I'm doing a disservice to my students by not remembering that. Okay. But you heard that little bit of Camptown Races. You heard it get into that fife and drum music section. Again, I do encourage you to check out more of Charles Ives, his other compositions. The Unanswered Question is, again, one of my favorites. The Piano Sonata No. 2 is very good. The Cage is also a very popular song that he did. All worth checking out. Please, please do. As always, I cannot encourage you enough to listen to a lot of this stuff. So, early America, we're just kind of behind. We're busy. We're doing governmental things. We're having lots of wars, right? And I had a lot of time for music. Okay? But once we got into this patriotic mood, like once we got that war blood flowing, we had great people like Sousa getting that concert march in the 19th century, Charles Ives moving forward as well. Again, just to remind you, that was about the turn of the century there for Charles Ives, right? Sousa was before that, I believe about 50 years before that. So... that's the chapter. Great. One more chapter. Let's get it done. Chapter 36. Concert music since 1920. Okay. 1920 is sort of the break we put because, you know, it's just a big year. It's a big year, right? A lot of things happened. Right? That was the ending of World War I was that, right? And then things very quickly go into the Great Depression and then World War II and then out of the Great Depression from World War II. So it was a very interesting time, the beginning of that 1900s, okay? So America starts to become this global player after the First World War, and it's really solidified after the Second World War. And that attitude is actually conveyed in the population, right? So we were spared the destruction of the world wars, but we still had an active involvement and could really feel like it was a good victory. A lot of musicians fled Europe, right? And that was because of World War I, and that was also with the impending of World War II, right? We know Mendelssohn left, which was a long time ago, but that was persecution before World War I. Arnold Schoenberg, who we talked about, he left. He left, I believe he was in Austria, and he got out of there before World War II hit. Again, Oliver Messiaen didn't get out, put into a concentration camp. You better believe he came to the United States after that. And so because of this, a lot of our music schools become stronger. We start having more of a focus on our music education, which is really exciting. We create the NEA, the National Endowments for the Arts, which was actually gutted by the current administration. That's not exactly something to really brag about now. I believe the funding on that was cut by 50% a couple years ago. So, rip. And, of course, advanced technology is always going to help. Always going to help music. So we have our own resurgence of American nationalism in this period of about 1935 to 1955. Samuel Barber, famous for his song Knoxville, and then it's a year, I forget what year it is. Howard Hansen, popular for working in New England, also was one of the co-founders of the Interlochen Center for the Arts, the longest-running music camp and music boarding school, arts boarding school in the country. He was also a proponent of music education. Yeah, really helped standardize and promote American music education. William Schumann was another New England guy, New England triptych, his nationalistic American work. And Aaron Copland, almost everything he did, American nationalism. The Billy the Kid suite, his Rodeo, his Appalachian Spring, which we're going to talk about next. He had a great piece about Lincoln. Lincoln Portrait is what it's called, where a reader will actually do an excerpt from Lincoln's speech. There's a great recording of James Earl Jones doing it on YouTube. Be sure to check that out. But the one that we're most familiar with is his Appalachian Spring, which is actually a ballet composed for Martha Graham. Martha Graham was an American dance instructor. Right? Very famous, very famous. And this is about courtship and a wedding of a couple in rural Pennsylvania. Just a nice, nice wedding, right? And what's more American than that, right? It contains a variation of Simple Gifts, which is a Shaker melody, one of the early religious groups here. It's trying to emulate that simplistic style of early America. And the dancing to it is actually pretty good, too. Again, Martha Graham is absolutely famous. Anyone who's taken dance instruction will know that name. Let's watch this. So this is actually Martha Graham dancing. Not her. Martha Graham plays the bride. This is the Simple Gifts. 'Tis a gift to... If you remember when we, at the beginning of the year, we listened to Simple Gifts. Try and remember back to 3 months ago. An interesting thing to note is this is the third time that we're seeing dancing in this class. The first time being the classical ballet style with Tchaikovsky's The Nutcracker. The second time being the primitivistic style of Igor Stravinsky in his Rite of Spring, made for the Ballet Russe. And now this is the third one. Notice how different it is. It's Each has its own little idiosyncrasies to it. Not as pretty as the ballet, but not as rigid and barbaric as the Stravinsky. And at the end of the day, it's trying to convey this simple, down-home feeling, this enjoyment of dancing, right? Reminds me of Madonna. Madonna was never trying to make beautiful dancing. She was trying to make dancing accessible. Look at that pose. Do it again. Oh, I didn't do it again. That's a shame. I want to freeze frame that pose, though. There it is. Oh, no, I need it. Okay, never mind. You can do it yourself. Sorry, I get distracted easily. You all know that. Okay? So that's Aaron Copland's Appalachian Spring, based on Simple Gifts, a Shaker Melody, and choreographed by Martha Graham. Okay? Another composer, and this is in 1985, is a woman named Ellen Toth-Zwillich. She did a Concerto Grosso in 1985. It's based on a Handel violin sonata, right? G.F. Handel, who famously did the Messiah, right? Oratorio. This alternates between the 20th century and the Baroque style, and it contains long pedal tones. Remember, pedal tones were used way back in the Renaissance tradition, right? So let's listen to this and see how these styles are combined. There's a pedal tone. The lowest note you can get. You'll hear it. It's not going to go away. Twentieth century style. Repeated. Now the Handel version, the Handel theme. Notice she even uses a harpsichord straight out of Handel's period. Beautiful, beautiful. Ah. And then back to that 20th century style. Excellent. Do yourself a favor and listen to that entire piece, right? That first movement is very short, but it is one of many. Let's talk a little bit about minimalism. Minimalism, again, was this artistic idea to try and make things interesting with a minimal number of elements to it. Some famous minimalistic art. Here are some triangles and waves. There's a circle, too. That's very nice. Here are some bold lines. That's very good minimalist art. I really enjoy that one. Let's see. Ooh, that's a good one. And this is absolutely my favorite. This is my favorite piece of minimalist art right here. Bunch of squares, some primary colors. Really, I'm a big fan of this. I'm not being satirical. I'm not being glib. I think it's great. I think it's beautiful. Yeah. So it was an artistic movement. It tries to do as little as possible and make things interesting. The idea is not to overwhelm people with things. It's just to try and do as much with as little as possible. So let's look at this guy, John Adams, famous Boston composer. His Short Ride in a Fast Machine. He's a minimalistic composer who's bored with minimalism. So let's see what he does with it. He's going to try and make things simple, right? He's going to try and use not a lot of elements. And so one thing that you're going to hear is this woodblock. It's going to go the entire time. Right. And then you're going to have some wind instruments enter, and they're going to be on one pitch. Bum, 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 bum. And then they're going to change what they do. Bum, 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 bum. And they're going to do it. And they're going to change it. Ba-dum, 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 ba-dum. Right. And they're just going to slowly change things. They're going to repeat things a lot, too. Right. So let's see how that goes out. Minimalism, right? Just try and think of a logical reason in a way that these simple things connect. So here you go. You see the minimalistic approach. Dun, 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 right? So let's see how those notes change. Let's see how he does it. It's a great work, 4 minutes long. Let's check it out. There's a little taste of Short Ride in a Fast Machine. I highly suggest you check that one out. Listen to the entire thing. John Adams is one of those composers who just sounds like John Adams a lot. One that I love is he did this opera called Nixon in China about when Richard Nixon visited China. And this piece is called The Chairman Dances. And so you can hear it has that same pulsing thing, that consistent, repeated feeling to it, right? You can see how these two pieces are done in the same style, and in this case, definitely by the same person. Those little splashes of color thrown in randomly. Yeah, very cool stuff. And again, that style is called minimalism. If you want to check out more John Adams, again, Nixon in China is a great opera. He also has one called Dr. Atomic, which is about the creation of the atomic bomb. Very interesting guy. I mean, you can just tell by the look at him that he'd be a dude with a story or two. So there you go, Advances in American Music. We had Aaron Copland in that nationalistic slant. Appalachian Spring with a theme from a Shaker hymn and Martha Graham doing the choreography for it. Ellen Toth Zilich in a Concerto Grosso 1985, combining the neoclassical style with the old Baroque style and adding in a touch of 20th century. And then minimalism as discussed and exemplified by John Adams in his Short Ride in a Fast Machine. Okay, I will have your test results up over the weekend. If you have any questions, please let me know. If you have not sent me your topic yet, please do that and get your topic confirmed. Other than that, thank you all for being here today. Have a great weekend.